greatest. Sweet. Sour. So good to taste.
Welcome to Great Taste on KRUU 100.1 FM, the solar-powered voice of Fairfield, Iowa. I'm Steve Boss, and we are coming to you live from Green Building Supply, where we're about to embark on a tremendous culinary adventure with all of you. Hopefully, you're adventurous in your listening and your viewing habits about food. So I hope that everyone is going to be a little bit probably taken aback by some of the things that they're going to hear in the next hour, simply because we're going to be discussing wild edibles. And I know the first time I ran across that term and also ran across eating wild edibles, I was totally floored. And maybe I'll describe that, maybe I won't, but it was a fantastic experience. And actually the first thing I ever ate, which was lamb's quarters, is one of the plants that we're going to be talking about and working with on this show. I have two guests. Tamaya is with us. Tamaya is assistant professor in the Sustainable Living Department at Maharshi University of Management, and he has been for over 15 years traveling the globe, working all over to help people understand the needs of our environment in terms of sustainability. And for 5 years, about 5 years, I think, he worked with us, 6 years, worked with the government of Bhutan to assist them in their transformation to what they hope to do in the next decade, and that is become the first country where all the agriculture in that entire country is raised in an organic fashion. So welcome.
Thank you, Steve. It's a pleasure to be on this show.
And you are going to be making lamb's quarters pakoras.
That's right.
And so this is a plant, lamb's quarters, that, as we heard from one of the people in our audience, her parents, farmers, really spent their time trying to get rid of it.
Yeah, I think most of the gardeners and people who have a piece of land around their house, they want to get rid of this wonderful plant. And it is called as a noxious or invasive weed over here in the U.S., unfortunately.
But in other countries, it's not.
Yeah, in Asia, for instance, in India, it is cultivated, and in many parts of Asia, it is used. It is collected from the wild, and it is used. It is very nutritious and has a lot of health benefits.
Terrific. And our other guest is Sasha Kisa, and Sasha is going to be talking about not only lamb's quarters, but several other types of wild edibles. And you have our co-director of a project, the NatureWise Academy, is that right? And you call it an eco-literacy type of program, and I don't even know exactly what that means, but welcome to the show, and maybe I'll become enlightened if we can describe, if you describe it a little bit.
Absolutely. Well, thank you very much for having me as well. This is kind of what my project, or my friend and I are kind of working on, and it's all about educating people about the intrinsic value of plants we find in nature, about nature itself. So we're kind of doing it right now, which is fantastic. We're going to be mixing a medley of wild edibles with some tempeh and some onion and a few other things as well. And as Dr. Tim was saying, there's so much nutrition in these wild plants, more so than in most store-bought vegetables. So we're really emphasizing just a tasty dish, but also a dish that is good for healing the body, for healing the palate, really. There's so many tastes in these foods. So.
Well, you are on the right show, and you're talking to the right person, because anything that has to do with taste, I'm a fan of. Julie, were you able to get that blender? Awesome. Okay, so we've got that. We'll be in the second half hour, we'll be working, or they'll be working on actually preparing a lot of the different dishes, and you're going to get to see Tim make the pakoras, right? And you're going to make a mint chutney?
Yeah, pakoras with a mint chutney.
Yeah, and I actually picked that mint myself, yeah. So I know it's fresh. I picked it today. And I would call it a wild edible because it's invasive, and it definitely doesn't stay where you want it to stay. It's like everywhere in my yard, so, you know, it'll count, right? It's okay.
I mean, there is wild mint in, you know, all across the area, so yeah, there's pretty much everything we have here can be found, you know, quote-unquote natively, but also there's a lot of culinary uses, as Dr. Tim was saying as well. And in a lot of other countries, these aren't considered wild plants as much as just plants that are used in specific dishes regularly.
And I think that's, it's kind of an interesting thought process, because Elaine Ingham was on the show a few, maybe a couple of months ago. And one of the things that she talks about is the soil as opposed to dirt, because dirt has this connotation, dirty, right? And the soil is a living organism and actually is something that, you know, we really need to have as healthy as possible to produce healthy items like all the different things that we see here. And I think it's kind of the same thing with these plants. They've gotten a bum rap over the years.
Yeah, I think there are certain terminologies which define things, and they give a very wrong picture, wrong connotation. For instance, like soil, when I teach organic agriculture course to my students, I don't use the word dirt. Soil is an abbreviated form of S-O-I-L, as source of infinite life. Similarly, the plants that we do not know, we just call them as weeds. But if we delve deeper into the subject, weeds are the complete plants. They follow the natural rhythms. And over a period of time, because of the industrial agriculture, we have lost the organoleptic qualities. I mean to say the taste and flavor, all the subtle qualities which these plants bring in. Because we have interfered in the natural process of the natural process of the growth of the plants. But these plants, which voluntarily grow, they know when to germinate, they know when to flower, they are very much attuned to the seasons. So in these plants, you have those subtle qualities which are complete in itself, and the nutritional values are much higher than the cultivated crops.
I know you were going to... I could feel that you had something else you wanted to say regarding that.
Oh, I'm just nodding and saying yes entirely. Exactly what Dr. Tim is saying. Even the USDA has research charts on most of these plants that we're using, probably all the plants we're using here today, and they far exceed what you'd find in the grocery store. I mean, lamb's quarter itself is probably one of the most nutritious plants you can eat. It's extremely rich in fat-soluble vitamins, and it's very good at pulling up minerals that are available in the soil if they are there. It's just a fantastic way to heal the body through nutrition.
There probably haven't been any longitudinal studies, though, on people today eating these types of things regularly in their diet, have there?
Well, Dr. Tim would be the person to ask about that. I think there have been a number of studies done on the nutritional content. I'm not sure about whether or not they've done studies on individuals consuming just one type of plant over a long period of time, but... you can, again, look this up on the USDA's actual website and just see that the nutritional content of some of these plants is just off the chart. It's this fantastic way to get, as Dr. Tim is saying, the nutrition and the taste, because the taste comes from the nutrition of the plant itself. If something is nutritionally devoid, then you taste a lack of flavor. So with lamb's quarter, for example, you'll really taste this richness, this kind of nutty or buttery flavor. And that's really what this is about, is people being satisfied, not just nutritionally, but also through their taste.
Yeah, I alluded to that at the beginning of the show when I said that the first time I ever tasted a wild edible, and it was lamb's quarters, I was completely blown away because, first of all, I had no idea that it was a quote-unquote wild plant, and secondly, I had no idea at all how rich the taste was. And it was at a dinner for Deborah Madison, who's been on the guest on the show numerous times, who happened to be in Fairfield at the time. She's a noted vegetarian cookbook author, chef, and so some of the local people were preparing the dinner for her, and one of the group, actually two sisters, made a lamb's quarters and kale casserole. And it had tofu in it, and it had lamb's quarters and kale, and it was just like, I took a bite out of it, and then they told me what was in it, and I couldn't even believe it, because it was so delicious. It had such a distinct flavor profile.
Yeah, if you look into the lamb's quarters plant itself, it's a family of quinoa. It's a family belonging to Chinopodium species. The Latin term chinopodium means, chino means goose, and podium means foot. If you see the leaf of the lamb's quarter, it looks like goose feet, and it's also called as goose feet. It's also called as pig's weed, and there are a lot of names for that. And it is the nutrition quality is very high when compared to spinach and quinoa. The seeds also can be cooked like quinoa with red rice and brown rice. So likewise, even in Fairfield, there are more than 10 to 15 different varieties, different species of wild edibles, which we call them as weeds, which grow all over. And this is a message from nature. I feel that, you know, to understand, it is conveying a message that there is abundance available in nature, not just feeding on wheat and potatoes and corn and maize as five or six crops. But if you can have diversity in the diet, the nutritional deficiencies that we see today, and you know, people are taking multivitamin supplements, all this can be avoided at a single stroke. Mm.
So maybe you could describe some of the different greens that are here and show the people that are watching this on live stream or YouTube later, and our listening audience can, of course, just use their imagination.
Absolutely. So as Dr. Tim has said, there's an abundance of wild edibles in Fairfield. We do, through NatureWise, a number of wild edible walks for the public, and we usually will fill up baskets of produce very easily, or baskets with produce, I should say, wild produce, very easily because of just the abundance that's here in the community. And to put things in perspective, there can be a lot of fear around these plants because some people might say, this looks like a poisonous plant, this does not. There are only a few poisonous lookalikes in Fairfield specifically. If you're with someone who is knowledgeable and you double check specifically the plant that you're eating is safe, not just with one person, but two people, possibly a credible source online as well is very useful, you'll find that the majority of plants either have some medicinal value or are just a common edible that can be cooked or prepared. So in terms of what we have today, we have some mallow, common mallow. It's an interesting plant. It's actually the source of most marshmallows. It's how early pioneers would make marshmallows in the first place. The seed has a mucilaginous quality. It's related to okra, and it has a very nice soothing effect on the stomach as well.
You know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to ask Tim if he has any input on each of these plants as you go through and describe them, because, sure, and also in terms of potentially where they might be used in other areas of the world too.
Yeah, for instance, this particular plant, which you can see, it's called as purslane, and the Latin name is portulaca. Basically, it's widely used as an ornamental plant, and it's used by the traditional people in different countries, and they are much superior than spinach, and it is rich in vitamin A, vitamin B, and C, similar like lamb's quarters. So most of these plants are used by the native people, like the Indian community over here. They also know a lot of medicinal properties, and similarly, there is another plant that comes up in your lawn, which is called as plantain. I don't know how many of you know that. It's not the banana variety. It is a green leaf, which grows like a grass, but it is slightly wider. At times you have, it is half the size of the palm, dark green in color with veins going straight. That particular plant is an amazing medicine for as a diuretic for urinary related problems, which is available in your garden. Another plant which I recently saw the Latin name is Solanum nigrum. It belongs to the nightshade family. It produces small black fruits, cherry like three fruits small, and if you consume it, it is slightly sourish in taste. Many years ago, I was told by a famous Ayurvedic doctor who is to advise some of the ministers in India and the high-profile people. He was telling me that this particular leaf, if you consume, it is the medicine for the kidney-related problems. So nature somehow provides solution in every locality, depending upon the region, altitude, and the consumption patterns of that particular place. So I can list a lot of plants which are easily available in this particular small little town called Fairfield. Yeah.
And the seasonal availability that Dr. Tim mentioned earlier is very important. I mean, if we had done this, say, in the spring, the spread of available produce, while lamb's quarter would probably still be there, there'd be a very different spread of wild edibles here, maybe more violet, things like this, things that will spring up more aggressively earlier in the year. And it's interesting to note that they all have different medicinal qualities as well. The neat thing about purslane as well is that it's one of the few sources of omega-3s you can get as a vegetarian. There's just so many finer nuances of the plants too that can be used beyond just internally. a lot of the different varieties of plantain, as Dr. Tim was mentioning, are not just nutritionally dense, but can be used topically for different skin ailments, or can be used in Russia. Actually, one of the common uses is as a natural facelift. It naturally tightens the skin when it's placed.
I'm sure that there are millions of people of all genders, I'll try to be politically correct, who are rushing outside now to see whether or not they can find that in their garden.
And the neat thing about these names, too, you'll notice pigsweed or lamb's quarter, a lot of these names come from farmers who have noticed that their animals will naturally fatten up when they use these, when these animals naturally find these plants and consume large quantities of them. Mm-hmm. So just to discuss a few more plants we have here, another one is wood sorrel, not to be confused with the more common, what people would usually associate in, say, a French sorrel soup. Wood sorrel is commonly confused with clover because of its leaf structure. Mm-hmm. It has a heart-shaped leaf rather than an oval clover leaf, and it's a really nice trailside plant. If you're hiking, I really encourage you to try that, actually, just biting the leaves off right there. It's very high in vitamin C. It's very tangy because of that. And if you're ever hiking, you can take a little bit of wood sorrel.
Wow.
Exactly, yeah, and crush it up and put it in water, and it's almost like making a trailside lemonade. Mm-hmm. Very refreshing. And vitamin C can give you that little bit of energy if you're hiking and need a little bit more oomph. So it's nice to cook and add some flavor as well. It adds a nice bitterness, but also a tanginess to a dish. We had some shepherd's purse in here as well, which is a nice kind of natural pepper almost in the mustard family. But actually, there it is right here. And this actually might be pennycress, not shepherd's purse.
Yeah,
it's pennycress. But if you want to try some of this, this is more like a natural pepper. Has that kind of mustardy, sharp flavor to it. Wow. Very concentrated in the seed, as you can taste that. Yeah,
that was the seed that I had.
Yeah.
Because mustardy. Mustardy and very sharp. Really great.
Mm-hmm. So you can actually spice your dishes. With
we are missing a lot of stuff, aren't
exactly,
we?
Exactly, yeah. Rather than buying your pepper or having to buy a lot of these spices that we don't really associate with wild crafting, you can actually season a dish, not beyond just putting a few greens in there.
Plus, there's other layers to the flavor I'm noticing in that. I mean, so you get a lot more with it. I'm not going to be able to describe it, but it was the finish to it that was totally different, you know, with the pepperiness and then this finish that had this extra dimension to it. Great.
Exactly. So that's basically what
we have the regular sorrel.
Yes, and again, the regular sorrel as well. And this is also a very tangy kind of flavor that we'll be adding in to balance out kind of the more bland primary protein. It has a heavier flavor, and so sharper flavors are nice to accent something that is usually a bit heavier on the palate.
And what's interesting is that some of these plants, well, for example, you say they're cultivated in other areas of the world, such as lamb's quarters, but sorrel also is cultivated here. People cultivate that.
Most of the species, depending upon the culinary habits, they are cultivated. But they are widely found in nature everywhere. But I feel since these vegetables, there's so much of diversity, the best thing is wildcrafting. You know, don't uproot all the plants. Just prune the plants or cut the branches, small little branches, and leave the root system over there itself so that they would come up again and again. And they are very resistant to regular prunings or cuttings, what you call a sustainable wild harvesting, so that we don't lose the plant for the next season. So in that way, you can cultivate your regular vegetables along with these plants, which you call as weeds. For instance, if you have lamb's quarters, most of the insects, they are very much, they are very intelligent. I would say insects are more intelligent than human beings. They would love to feed on the lamb's quarter leaves so that you don't have an insect problem. You can grow your okras or capsicums or tomatoes. They do not want to eat tomatoes because it is a variety which has been bred. There is a human interference in it. The insects know about it. They'll go to lamb's quarters or other weeds and get all their nutrition. So the weeds, what you call, I would like to call them as supreme plants, divine plants, you know, they can be grown along with the main crops. And it's a very wrong notion that the weeds compete with for water and nutrition and stuff like that. That was the argument to support the industrial type of agriculture. So they can coexist. And it is just the knowledge which is extremely important in this case. Wild edibles or organic farming, all these good things in life are knowledge intensive. You know, if you know what plants to pick, I think we need not be dependent on the cultivated crops. So a lot of our nutritional requirements can be met from our backyard garden itself.
Okay, so I'm a little confused as to exactly, let's just say, this fall, next spring, whatever, I'm taken, you know, in with some of this, these things that I've tasted. Am I going to grow them? Am I actually going to plant them in my yard? Or am I going to go out into the woods and try to find them? I mean, I don't know exactly how to integrate this information into my dietary habits.
It's very interesting, actually. Most of these plants will be found in disturbed soils. So you'll actually more likely than not find most of these in your backyard rather than in a young forest in a trailside system in Iowa. You will still find an abundance of edibles regardless of where you go for the most part. But a lot of these plants, and this is kind of coming back to this natural intelligence you find in nature, really do favor disturbed soils, sites that human influence has had an impact on. So when you see a freshly tilled farm, there's always the most weeds there. You just see an abundance of lamb's quarters or sorrel or purslane or whatever it might be. Everything is just popping up all at once because these seeds are finally given a chance to germinate. And there's this indescribable intelligence that just tells the right plants to grow at the right time, and for whatever reason they usually always seem to have the right kind of medicinal value for the organisms in that area, namely the humans that have disturbed the soil. So there's many ways of going about it. You can go and wildcraft out in nature, you can wildcraft in your own backyard, you can even, it's really interesting, you can even buy what used to be classified as weeds just a decade or so ago on most popular nursery websites or seed nursery websites these days. So there's really a number of different ways to do it. But for the most part, if you disturb your soil in your backyard and come back to it a few weeks later, you'll have dinner. So,
okay, so all I have to do is just uproot some patch of ground in my yard and come back in a few weeks.
Or just let it grow even. See, we have this habit of reducing our grass lower and lower to the ground, keeping it neat and tidy. And a lot of these root systems or a lot of these plants are already there waiting to come up. Even grass, for example, grass is an extremely nutrient-dense plant that can be harvested and turned into a drink. And wheatgrass, for example, is just one example of many grasses that are edible.
For some reason, it doesn't sound as romantic as these. I mean, you know, it's like...
Well, in some cases, it might be more medicinal, though. So it really depends on what you're looking for. But again, there's many ways of doing it.
Okay. All right. Well, that's very helpful. How many people, by the way, you know, just let me see your hands. How many people are intrigued enough right now that they want to think a little bit about how this might work in their own backyard? Yeah. Yeah. I know. It's like crazy. It's. Anybody have this experience where you're actually wildcrafting yourselves? Anybody here? Oh, Sue. Do you want to come up here for 1 second? Come on. Come on. Just for 1 second. All right. Well, but you like doing it, right?
Yes.
Okay. Well, there you go. She said she did. So that's terrific. Okay. So how can this information and the integration of this information into, let's say, the diet of our civilized, and I use that term very loosely, form of agriculture impact the future of agriculture in a, we'll say, in a more positive way?
I think if we can integrate these wild edibles, it'll benefit the mankind to a very large extent. What is required is creating awareness. I think what you are doing at the moment is creating awareness about these plants. Those people who are hearing this would definitely go out to their gardens and look for lamb's quarters and maybe may try some recipes out of it. At the same time, it is not just the identification of these plants, it's also the recipes that are required. Like, can we make around 20 recipes out of lamb's quarters or porcelain or any other species? I think that is very important. That requires some experimentation, you know, because each one of us have our own choices. You know, we have our own choice of a particular type of food. Some may like Italian, some may like Mexican. So how do we integrate these species into the recipes that we like? I think that is very important, along with creating awareness.
One of the things that it's done for me already is it makes me want to look very closely into our restaurant culture right now and to see whether or not I've missed this trend, whether it does exist in some we'll say, really avant-garde places that are doing really interesting things for the palates of their customers, or whether we haven't hit it yet. And I want to say that we haven't hit it yet, right? Okay. We have hit it?
You know,
you see a lot of it in North Carolina. Okay, so there are some places, I think isolated, unless I'm just not reading the right articles, where this information is getting into the restaurant culture. But it's got to reach a critical mass, actually, in the restaurant culture for there to be a lot more awareness in the general public. Because really, it's restaurants that tend to set the trend for a lot of the way people think when it comes to eating food. So I think that it's really going to be interesting to take a look at, you know, where some of the, you know, top chefs are going with this. And if you have something to say, please come up here and say it, because don't be as shy as Sue, because no one can hear you. No one can hear you. So do you know how tough it is to be the host of a show? Yes. Well, that's true. The farmers markets, I mean, Sasha has lamb's quarters for sale at his little place in the farmers market, and that's true. But I guess I'm trying to put this in perspective. Let's talk about Dan Barber, for example, and Blue Hill at Stone Barns, and his whole idea of the third plate, which is basically that chefs have been off track in actually working with farmers, because the whole idea has been chefs go to the farmers and say, hey, if you'll grow this, this, and this, then I'll buy it. And the realization he came to was, what are you growing? What does grow here naturally in your environment? I'll buy it to help support what, you know, is happening in your environment. So I guess that's the same kind of thing that has to happen with this. These are plants are ubiquitous all over, and I'm sure there are many other varieties found in different parts of the states, for example. Mm-hmm. And it's got to be where that becomes a trend then, where chefs are actually, you know, putting it more and more into their menus, so that people are looking at it and go, hey, where do I get this purslane? Where do I get this, you know, these lamb's quarters, you know, that type of thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. We've kind of mentioned this already, but it does really come from more of an awareness of reconnecting to your natural environment. The idea of a weed in general is defined in many different ways depending on who you talk to. It can be a plant who's displaced in terms of its value to the agricultural developer, or it can be a plant that's a nuisance for whatever reason, or just naturally invasive, or has an aggressive growth pattern. So it really depends what your relationship is like with the plants in your environment, or how you view nature in general. There's a very classic way of seeing nature in terms of dominating it and controlling this wild beast. And I think that has kind of contributed to our detachment from what can naturally grow in our backyards. So I think it's not just restaurant culture, but also a general paradigm for how we relate to nature, how we connect with our environment.
You're listening to Great Taste on KRUU 100.1 FM, the solar-powered voice of Fairfield, Iowa. I'm Steve Boss, and we're talking about Wild Edibles live at Green Building Supply, who is the sponsor of our show. And also, we want to thank everybody's Whole Foods for contributing many of the ingredients that we use on a monthly basis here. We're live here at Green Building Supply every first Tuesday of the month, and next first Tuesday, which I think is September 1st, but I'm not actually positive at the moment, we are going to be featuring the farmers market, and many of the growers from the farmers market will be here on that first Tuesday. So we hope we'll have you tune in, and if you're a local, be here and enjoy it with us. I know we need to get to cooking, so we're going to be doing that in the second half of the show now. And at the same time, I'm hoping to talk, while one of you is busy making things come together, I'm hoping to talk with the other about the different missions that they have, because I'd love to talk with you a little bit about biodynamics and about your role in terms of making more awareness of this particular type of agriculture. And I'd love to talk with you about the whole idea of making this knowledge more available to everyone, because I think that's part of your mission in terms of the NatureWise Academy. So let's do that as we move along. First of all, let's talk about the bakoras, because you might want to tell people exactly how you're going to make these, and while you're blending then for the mint chutney, I'll talk to Sasha about NatureWise Academy.
Pakoras are a very common snack in India and Nepal and in Bhutan and many of these.
Pre-mixed.
So you can use different types of vegetables, but I, for this particular show, I want to show how to use lamb scotters in making pakoras. The first thing is try to collect the tender leaves of a lamb scotters, clean them twice or thrice. On the leaves, there is a powdery little substance on the on the leaves of the lamb scotters. It's not poisonous, but you know, while cleaning, you may feel that what it is and may think that it's some poisonous material or something like that, but it is not. If you clean it a couple of times, that powdery substance goes off. And once you have the leaves, put, say, sufficient quantity of, if you have, say, 1 pound of leaf, put quarter pound of gram flour onto it.
Chickpea flour
or gram flour or garbanzo flour, okay? And then chopped ginger, depending upon your taste, a little bit of salt, oregano, and jalapenos. Jalapenos you can use, or chili powder you can use. And you can also use the dried mango powder, which is called as amchur, or dry mango powder, which is commonly available in the Indian store. And also to give a rich flavor of true Indian pakoras, there is a pakora masala, which is a mixture of different spices, which you'll also get in the Indian store. A quarter teaspoon, a little bit of it you can put in, and then make into a thick batter. And keep it for a while of 2 or 3 minutes, and then heat the oil, preferably coconut oil or safflower oil, what you call as straight oils. Now, never use refined oil because it doesn't have any nutrients in it. Preferably organic oils, and heat the oil, let it be really hot, and then take a spoon and put small little dumplings into the heated oil, and the smell that it generates while cooking, I'm sure you'll all be, your mouth would be watering, and also the people from all over Fairfield may just come over here like the honeybees. Yeah, it has a very strong aroma, and it's a nice aroma, and it is very nice to eat, as a snack. And along with it, you can prepare chutneys. Chutneys are the ground material using different types of leaves. Over here today, we are making mint chutney. You take a small, a bunch of mint, around 5 or 6 plants, tender leaves, chop them into fine pieces, and put a small piece of ginger and some chili or jalapenos and a little bit of salt in it, and then make a thick paste. And it's so simple. That's what chutney is all about, mint chutney. And you dip this pakoras in the mint chutney and have it. And it's divine, it's awesome, and it's very tasty, and you cannot stop eating,
So get to work. Come on, let's go.
Yeah.
All right, so I, if you need some help, Julie or Val, somebody, if you don't mind, because I think Tim might need to get some coconut oil into the pan, and he might need some help with the jalapenos, and the mint is not washed. I forgot to wash that, so just to let you know. So we'll get out of your way. And we'll move these chairs a little bit out of the way, and Sasha and I will talk a little bit. And then when you get that ready, now it's time to work, then we'll talk about biodynamics. All right? All right. Sounds like a plan. So here we go. All right. So thank you all very much for coming to help. So let's discuss a little bit about, first of all, you're a graduate of the Sustainable Living Program, right?
I'm not.
You're not. Okay, let's be specific. tell us your background.
Okay, well, I designed my own major at MUM, and it's specifically called Sustainable Community Development. Mm-hmm. I really wanted to focus most of my time on outreach and engaging with the community in general. So a lot of what I did for my degree is specifically hands-on experience, and that has led me to develop a lot more insight into wild edibles and into urban agriculture and sustainable community development in general.
Okay, and could you define sustainable community development?
So community development in general is usually to enrich a local community, whether it be its resilience or its just general networked kind of resilience. There's a many different avenues, almost like social work has, you know, 10 or 11 or 12 or 15 even different specific concentrations. Community development is really about just engaging with your community, whether it be a city or town, and interfacing in one specific aspect at least. I specialized in food sovereignty and engaging community around this idea of food, whether it be wild edibles or urban agriculture. Sustainable, as you know, is a ability for it to regenerate, to last a long time without degrading or becoming a necrotic system. And so sustainable community development is developing a community in terms of its natural environment. How can you make it resilient without degrading the ecosystem that it resides within?
Okay. And then the specialty is in regard to food.
Exactly.
So how can you create a sustainable food economy within any type of community, and obviously it's specific to the community that you're working in, and have, I assume, every part of that community be able to share in the benefits that you're creating? Because we hear that so many of the different types of food trends that exist are really only available to people with certain income levels. And this is not necessarily true, but it does have, there is a perceived value that that's true. We do know the reality of food deserts in communities where some different parts of the communities are not able to have access to fresh food. So that's a real problem. And so how do you see this particular, I'm assuming this is part of your endeavor, the whole idea with wild edibles, but so how do you see this integrating into making healthy food and the knowledge of healthy food choices as part of growing a community, a healthy community?
Mm. Well, everyone has to eat. That's the main idea. And what you eat is really dependent on how you were raised, your lifestyle, and really the knowledge that you have. So it's food for thought. Sorry.
I love it.
Okay, good. This the idea of knowledge is power. So if you educate someone that the plant growing in their backyard is the most nutritious plant they've ever eaten in their life, then they're no longer living in a food desert. And it's just that little bit of knowledge that changes their entire paradigm or their entire idea of being surrounded by acres and acres and acres of corn, and yet we're termed as a food desert. It's a very strange concept. So the idea, first and foremost, is knowledge, engaging people through workshops, through exactly what we're doing here today, and educating them and having them experience it, whether they're picking it or identifying it for themselves or developing a relationship with the plant in nature. The main idea is to get hands-on experiential knowledge through hands, heart, and mind, the full spectrum of experience.
And are you creating essentially a program that can then be replicated essentially? So it's kind of like a trademarked type of course of study in a sense that you can then take to a different city or to a different rural community and they can just do the same thing?
I don't think we'll trademark it, but it's definitely the idea of being able to replicate this across well, in any community really. The idea is to keep it as open source as possible. This information is a birthright to anyone who's on the planet, really. If you can identify plants in your environment that are edible, it's essential to your survival. And so if you know how to grow food or ecologically manage the soil in your environment, this is crucial knowledge that you can't really put a price tag on. So we're still figuring out how exactly to meet capitalism with this idea of open source knowledge, but it's working out really well so far.
Well, it's worked out in the technological world really well, yeah, in terms of open source. Yeah, right. So now what I think is also kind of, I started to think about this just when you were explaining that, and that is when you think about one particular type of food, mushrooms, mm-hmm. for some reason they have a mystique, I think, about them that causes people to really not only go out and look for them, and this is all over the world, not just in our local area where morels, for example, are prized, but all over the world, different varieties of mushrooms where people are like crazed, essentially, mm-hmm. to find these particular mushrooms, to never divulge their source of where they found them, etc. So it's kind of interesting to me, just thinking about that, we don't have the same type of passion, I guess, that's directed to these kinds of plants. I'm kind of feeling that they might feel like have a little inferiority complex or something like that.
Well, it's definitely a subculture, and to be honest, so is the mushroom hunter or the mushroom culture in general. My lovely wife is here, actually. She helped me prepare a lot of these wild edibles today and harvest them, and she has a natural gift for finding mushrooms.
Oh, really?
She can just find chanterelle, or she can just find morels. It's
really?
Thing. And so there is...
Can I borrow her for a while?
You have to talk to her about that. It really is a magical thing or a mysterious thing, as you said, because first and foremost, the mushroom has a very short lifespan. It's just the fruiting body of a much larger organism, the mycelial net. And so what you're looking for is a very short lived, maybe a week, maybe a few days, depending on the environmental conditions, so that there's a certain mystique there. It pops up and is gone almost instantly. Second of all, it has very unique environmental requirements to a high level of moisture for the most part. And there are a lot of poisonous lookalikes, much more so than with wild plants. And so there's a certain kind of reverence and also fear of mushrooms because of that. So there's it's a very unique, you almost have a different, or your own show just talking about mushrooms and culinary uses of mushrooms because not,
that would be. Can we do that?
Yeah.
Okay, we're on. I mean, definitely we're on because I am a huge mushroom fan, so truffles even more, but we can't do that here, so yeah. Sorry.
No. I totally approve of that. That's fantastic. And beyond just their culinary uses, they're used for bioremediation, but also for curing a number of health ailments. Paul Stamets, he's a mycologist in the Pacific Northwest. He's done some NIH research showing that turkey tail mushroom is one of the most powerful anti-cancerous medicines that are out right now. And it's not just, this isn't... hippie subculture, whole herb healing kind of stuff. This isn't something that can get tossed out that easily because it's NIH funded. This is real data showing that you can shrink and destroy tumors using this mushroom that's native to North America. So, and to a number of other areas as well. So,
and you can eat it at the same time.
You can eat it at the same time. Yeah, it's really incredible. Yeah.
That's awesome. That's terrific. I want to just move over. I'll let you get back to work for a second and move over here and see now what I love about what you're doing. And I want you to, I want everybody seeing this, right, Jason? Is people in our culture, let's put it that way, in our general culture, they almost never use their hands. They're missing so much fun in cooking, aren't they?
Yeah, I think the fork and spoon culture has spoiled the culinary, I think the respect for the food, I believe, because I was trying this, but you don't get that consistency. There's nothing like hand, clean hands. You just mix with hand and it mixes so well. And if you, especially for this particular preparation, if you don't use your hand, it doesn't blend because you also have to apply a little bit of pressure for the juices of that plant to come out. And please use your hands. It's more sustainable,
And it's fun.
It's fun. And you should try eating rice with your hands. And it knows the exact temperature. It knows the exact taste. And you're connected with it, You cannot see a computer and heat with your hand, because you need to balance very well. Otherwise, the entire morsel of food will fall down. More than that, I think we have lost that touch. If you look into, say, around 50 or 60 years ago, even farmers had the knowledge of feeling the soil. Our sensory systems are so amazing that feeling aspect is so important. I prefer to use hands in cooking, it makes the food much more tastier.
Yeah, and I think there's a little bit of a, we'll say, esoteric part of it too, which is that you're actually putting your energy into the food right there. People who are getting to or partake of it are actually partaking of all the effort and time and the actual physical nature and energy of you, Tim, putting that into these pakoras. So I think that's important.
Yeah, I think you have touched a very important subject, Steve. I think human energy has a lot of importance in cooking. I was told by a saint around 20 years ago in Sri Lanka that while cooking, keep chanting some prayers. And he used to suggest chanting the supreme mantra, that is the Gayatri mantra. And you would have seen that in India, in the community kitchens, most of the temples provide free food for people who visit the temple. Same as the Sikh temple. You know, you go to any Sikh temple in any place, they provide free food. And the people who cook are all volunteers. They're not chefs, they're volunteers. And while cooking, they keep chanting the names of the Lord or the mantras. They keep chanting. And the food that turns out is amazing. You know, the taste is amazing. You would have seen in your own house, like your spouse, at times when she prepares a cup of coffee, the coffee tastes amazing. It's the same brand of coffee, same fire, same water, same vessel, everything is the same. At times the coffee or tea or whatever drink or the food tastes wonderful. Just go back a few hours before she has prepared that particular dish or a coffee. It all depends on the mood. If she's fine, not stressed out, that particular coffee tastes good. So this has been in our experience every day, you know. And that's the reason energy is very important. Cooking is like meditation. And never hear anything loud noise. Have a soothing music or listen to some nice bhajans, or you just chant while cooking, you know. And the food automatically tastes good. And you need not measure anything. Everything is approximation. You know, leave it to the creator of the materials. Yeah. Yeah. So energy is extremely important. In the modern day, we have disconnected ourselves from this energy connections. So
there's an interesting Buddhist group in Northern California, in Ukiah, California, and there's a restaurant there. I think it's called the Land of 10,000, the Monastery of 10,000 Buddhas or something like that, because there's one room in there where there's 10,000 sculptures, you know, that are mounted. And they have a restaurant just like you're talking about, where it's all run by volunteers, and it's crazy good. I've been there numerous times, and every time I go, it's just like, why is this so much better than anywhere else? And we're talking about Asian food, you know, basically the kind of things that you might find in different types of Chinese restaurants or some Thai places, things like that. Nothing super exciting or, you know, crazy, just kind of regular vegetables and rice. But the flavors are just outstanding.
Yes.
And I think it must be partly from what you're talking about.
Yeah, it's all to do with the energies. You just try it out. You just play a bhajan while cooking, you know, and the food would be amazing, whether it's a Buddhist bhajan or a Sikh bhajan or a Christian prayer or any faith that you follow, you know. That divinity is extremely important in cooking. Cooking is a divine activity. So that's the reason in India, people don't put on their footwear while cooking, because the kitchen.
They don't put on their what?
Footwear.
They don't put on shoes and things like
that. Or anything. They cook barefooted, because kitchen is considered as the second temple, and that's where food is produced. And the Vedic scriptures say that annahe purna brahmaha, which means that food as the signature of the entire cosmos, you know. So the way it is produced, the way it is processed, the way it is cooked is extremely important. And everything has to do with the energies. It is not with proteins, carbohydrates, and fats. It is with the human energy, you know. So let's cook with human energy today.
Yeah, I am all for it. Now, I am a little, I have to admit, my faith is going to have to get a lot stronger to just walk into anybody's kitchen, and just because they're playing, you know, some type of prayer or bhajan, I'm not sure that I'm going to, you know, find their food up to my liking. But I'm willing to try, you know, at different times. We'll see. All right. Can you just give us a quick understanding of what biodynamic agriculture is about? Because most of our listeners, I'm sure, are very familiar with the term organic. But what the heck is biodynamic?
Yeah, biodynamic is, I would call it as an advanced state of organic farming. It's the next stage of organic farming, or I would say it is organic plus. What happens in organic farming is we are stopping the use of agrochemicals, you know. and using natural means like composts and row crops and natural sprays for managing pests. But in biodynamics, we consider farm as an organism. Like each individual of us is a complete organism, and we have, though we are human beings, we have our own preferences. Similarly, every farm is unique in itself. So we consider farm as an organism and accordingly work on it. And we take the nature cues or the messages from nature. We keep our eyes and mind open and understand the messages from nature. For instance, weeds. We ask questions, why do these weeds grow so well? Not the crops. If you are planting a crop, you need to tend it, you need to water it, you need to put some compost, there are some pests coming in, you need to manage the pests, but nothing happens in a weed. What is that which is so special in weeds? And we understand that it knows exactly when to take birth, when to germinate. It follows the rhythm of nature. So can we convert a crop into a weed? Yes, it is possible. You follow the rhythm. So we use the lunar calendars or planting calendars. And this knowledge has been with the people for generations. They used to follow the moon's calendar for planting. We use the moon's calendar for planting and bring that natural rhythm into the crops that we cultivate. There is nothing waste in biodynamic farming system. Everything has a use. We see the whole nature, whatever plants and animals that exist around, has a purpose, and it has a meaning in this for its own existence. And in that way, we go deeper, not just by substituting the agrochemicals with natural ones, but also going deeper into the whole process. And regarding the processing in biodynamic farming, we call it as a gentle processing process. We don't want to modify the material. We want to maintain the integrity of that particular produce. For instance, if you're making wine, we don't allow in biodynamics to add sulfites or any artificial cultures for making wine. It changes the very nature of the wine. The wine should be as natural as our grandfathers used to prepare or grandparents used to prepare. It should represent the qualities of the soil. It should represent the qualities, true qualities of the of that particular variety of grapes. So it is fermented naturally. And that's the reason biodynamic wines are very expensive in the market. And most of the wine growers are going into biodynamics because of the additional premium that they're getting. Whether they're interested in biodynamics or not, that's a different issue. So in Italy, there are large number of farmers who are going into biodynamics. One, because of the spiritual connection that it has got, and it is totally different from organic farming. So I would say the first step is getting into organic, and the next step is getting into biodynamic. And the third, ultimate, final step is Vedic organic agriculture, wherein we use the sounds of nature. We try to purify the atmosphere by some of simple practices so that the food, that the farming ecosystem or the farm ecosystem is transformed into a forest-like ecosystem. It's grown as it is grown in the forest. Yeah.
Fantastic. Okay, so let's really quickly, you're going to make little, can you just show us, do you have everything in here that you need so you can just show us one little pecora? Is it a pecora? That's the singular?
Yeah. In English, it is called as pecora, but in Hindi, it is pakoda, D. You know, they call us pakoras, but in English it is written as pakoras. They say pakoras. I think in the West it's difficult to pronounce D. Okay. So what I've done is I've mixed all the ingredients, and while mixing, please use your hand and then keep pressing a little bit so that the natural juices of this lamb scotters come out. Okay. And we have used gram flour, chilies or jalapenos, a little bit of oregano, a little bit of salt, a small slice of ginger, then dried mango powder, and the pakoda masala. If you don't have pakoda masala, you may not use it, okay? And mix it so that you have a consistency like this, okay? And then, yeah. So now heat the oil, You can also put your finger and test whether the hay haw. Don't do that. Don't do that.
We're not responsible for our guests say on this program, so don't.
Don't do that. Okay.
So then, are you just going to make a little ball, basically?
Yeah. Make a small ball like this. Okay. It's much easier making a ball like this. Just let me mix it once again because the moisture goes down. Yeah. So make a small ball like this, and first we have to see whether the oil is heated or not. I think it is. It is not fully heated. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Nice.
Yeah.
Okay. So just little small balls, and you don't want to crowd them in the pan, of course, because then the oil temperature will go down way too fast, and you'll have soggy pakoras. Yeah.
We'll make space them a few inches apart. Yeah.
Kinds of stuff going on around here.
Yeah,
I'm getting further and further away. Tim, I'm gonna run over before they throw me completely out of here. I'm gonna run over here and talk to Sasha. What are you doing over here now? You've got going over in this pan. You've got tempeh. Now, I think a lot of people potentially may not be familiar with that.
Okay, tempeh is quite a bit like tofu. It's a bit more cultured, in the sense that it's been fermented. There's some talk of whether or not it's more digestible because of that. I find it a little more soft on my digestive tract, I guess you could say. So it's a nice alternative to a meat protein. And so we're using that to kind of cook our wild edibles around. So a lot of the tastes in wild edibles are very strong. And so the main protein helps to kind of ground all of it in terms of the unique flavors that we're mixing together.
Okay. And then in this particular pan, what do we got going on here?
So this is also lamb's quarters. I'm doing that separately, specifically to demonstrate how this stocks, when they're caught at the right time of year, can be used as an alternative to asparagus.
So what does that actually look like? Can we pull one out of here?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. Right here. So what will happen is, and these are very thin stalks too, you can get them quite a bit thicker if they're young still. These are later in the year, and so there's a lot more fiber even in the younger stalks at this point in time. So if you look over the tape later, you'll see that I've been kind of picking through them looking for the right ones that are just soft enough. But you'll see here that the stem itself will soften, and then the leaves will kind of wrap around it. And rather than paying $12 a pound for asparagus, you can get nice, young, thick lamb's quarter stalks, and they taste like a nutty, kind of buttery asparagus. The trick is to catch them when they're nice and thick and young again. If they are too thick and they've been there and they kind of don't snap off easily, but they're very...
get too woody then.
Exactly. Yeah, you'll just chew them and chew them and chew them. And unfortunately, because of the time of year, a few of these may be like that today. But you'll at least get the flavor and the taste of what it will be like to catch them earlier in the season. So I thought it was worth the risk of having a few fiber-rich stalks.
Just hey, if you don't take a risk, you know, life isn't exciting. So, all right. So
This is a very thin stalk compared to what you'd pull earlier in the season, something maybe half the size of a dime or something like that.
We're looking for something that's thicker.
Much thicker than this. Thicker. The problem here is that even this thin stem is very fiber dense at this time of year, mm-hmm. later in the season. Mm-hmm. So
basically, lamb's quarters are better in the spring.
Spring and summer, yeah. As soon as they start getting woody, the leaves are still fine. The leaves are great. Dr. Tim has pulled a lot of leaves together, and those will be good throughout the entire year. But the stalks are going to be better much earlier on.
All right. Sasha Kisa from NatureWise Academy has been our guest. Tamaya from the Sustainable Living Department at Maharshi University of Management. And we are really fond of coconut oil on Great Taste. We've been coming to you from Green Building Supply. Thank you for tuning in 60 minutes of delicious radio on Crew.
Great Taste. Sweet. Sour. So good the taste.